Stevie.
Is this guy beautiful or is this guy beautiful? I first met him, I didn't know whether to shake his hand or kiss him. I'll tell you that right now.
Geez, you're pretty.
Okay, I'm gonna ask you a question I know you haven't been asked in a long time. How's your knee?
Actually, I've been trying to think of every time I'm asked to give a creative answer, something a little different, but I've run out of answers now, and fortunately, it's fine, and the best answer I can give is that it's 100% right now.
Are you going to wear a brace at the start?
I don't think so. I had one made in the playoffs last year, and you know, the people that say that, or the people that make the braces say that they're great, and obviously for obvious reasons, but the doctors say they don't. There's real no evidence that a brace prevents an injury or protects against an injury. But the one that I was wearing, it helped me at the time, but it's very cumbersome. And
were you a little scared when you came back? Jeez, you know what I mean?
Well, not really. I talked a lot, and I spent a lot of time with the doctors talking about it, and there wasn't really any risk of, or any more risk of me playing in the playoffs or waiting until September and playing again. The ligament that I tore, I tore it completely in half, and there was no risk in damaging it again, obviously, because it wasn't there. So the important thing was to get the strength back in my leg, and I managed to do that, and I was ready to play.
Well, what do they do? Like, what do they do with the ligament? Do you tell you? Do they staple them on?
No, they, in the past, I guess they used to go inside and stitch them together, but I guess over time, that's proved that it isn't successful. And with this injury, they felt the best thing to do, and they went in and they did arthroscopic surgery and looked around, and they felt the best thing to do is just leave it. So I guess the ligament just kind of fades away to nothing, and it's important that you keep the muscles around your knee strong to compensate.
I remember Bobby Orr, poor Bobby, everywhere, he said after a while I was going to make a sign, the knee is fine. And the very first operation on him, like, you know, and he had scars on his leg that long, you know. And now they make the, how big was your scar?
I have four little X's that you can't even see, and they just, what they do is put a tube in, and when they scope a knee or whatever, they just stick a little tube in and look around, and there's four little X's that you can't really notice.
Two great years under Jacques, eh? He's quite a coach, isn't he?
He's done great things for our team in Detroit. He has some different ways, and I've really enjoyed playing for him. He's done a great job in Detroit, definitely.
One thing, you never fall asleep.
He doesn't let you get away with much. The guys we've come to, there's a phrase best describes Jacques and the way he coaches it. He gives you just enough rope to hang yourself, and usually you do hang yourself, and he gets you for it.
You know, I say about your knee, and you come back against Edmonton, and I said to somebody, I said, it's a good job he played a good team like Edmonton, because Edmonton, there's no way Edmonton would run at you, you know what I mean? A couple of guys, but I mean, you know what I mean? Like, if you had to play Boston or Philly, one of those teams that had to hit, it'd have been a lot tougher.
Yeah, I think Edmonton is a very disciplined team, and they've over the years they've become even more disciplined. And if it was to our benefit, if we could get them taking runs at not just me but anybody, and that gets them away from their wide open fast-paced game, and if we could get them doing that, but they didn't bother with it. They weren't at all concerned about it. That's not their game.
Nope.
And like I said, they're very disciplined, and they stuck to their game.
You know, you had made a statement earlier in your career that in the summer you said, "Geez, I'd better wake up." You know, I could be out of hockey. I mean, what do you mean by that?
Well, that was 3 years ago, and we just struggled through the worst year in my short career with Detroit, and I think the worst year in Red Wings history, and I think we won a total of 17 games all year, and myself, I got injured halfway through the year and missed 30 games, and I ended up with a total of 14 goals, and it was a really disappointing year, and I guess during an interview one time, you know, I did a lot of thinking, and you only get so many chances, and you can't really afford to throw it away. And I kind of said to myself that I better take this a little bit more seriously and realize what a great opportunity I have and make the most of it.
You know, your first year, you were like you were really small. You know what I mean? Like, you really look small. Then, after a while, I mean, next year, it looked like you were... What the heck happened? Did you get, like, Scott into the weights or what?
Well, unfortunately, I didn't get the same program he did because mine ain't working quite like his.
Nobody's is. Nobody's is.
I'm going to have to check that. My first couple... Well, I was only 18 years old and, when I came, and part of it was just growing up and maturing and filling out. And I've worked... 3 years ago, I broke my collarbone and... missed 30 games, and I think I weighed about 160 pounds at the time, and I decided that I better put on a little weight and get stronger if I want to play a full season and want to play well, and I've tried to do that by, again, on a weight program and working hard in the off season, and I'm a little bit heavier, and I feel a little stronger, and it's benefited me.
The youngest guy ever to play in the All-Star. I mean, that must have been something walking in the room with these guys.
That was a big thrill for me. It was my rookie year, and I didn't really expect it. I was a late addition to the team. I think about five or six guys got hurt, and they ran out of guys, and they took me.
No, I don't believe that, but go ahead.
That was a thrill. You know, I didn't expect it. And a couple days before the game, they asked me to come and play, and that certainly was a thrill.
And the youngest captain ever in the National Hockey League. Now, when Jock asked you, what did you think? I mean, geez, all Harold Snepps and all those guys?
Well, he had asked me, this was when Jock was, he was named coach of the Red Wings in, I think, June of 86, I think it was. And he called me later in the summer, and when I met with him in Detroit, and presented the idea to me and asked me what I thought about it and told me to go home for a couple weeks and think about it. And you know, I'm not really sure what a captain does or what his role is supposed to be, but I've tried to be a leader, and we had so many older guys in the team, and I was concerned that I didn't want to rub anybody the wrong way or seem pushy or offend anyone. And fortunately, I have played with some great veterans and guys like Michael Connell and Harold and Glennie Hanlon that have really helped me out, and again, I've tried to be very subtle and low-key in my approach.
You made Team Canada in your young year, and the second year you didn't make it. What the heck's going on there?
Well, I was fortunate enough that Mario Lemieux wasn't old enough to play in it my first year, and when he came along, he kind of stole my position. And I'm in a difficult position playing behind Gretzky, Messier, Dale Hawerchuk, and Mario, so I really didn't expect to make the team going into the camp. But
you got 50 goals, and Blue, she's got a great clip, you know, Blue, she always does it. She likes Detroit. You ready, Blue? Roll that clip. Let's see it right here. Can you describe this now?
I believe that's my 50th goal. It wasn't a real pretty one, but we were on a power play, and Lee Norwood fired the puck, dumped it in from behind the net, and it was a wide open side, and actually I was going far corner and missed
it. Pull it in like that. Yeah. Just pull it in, that's a great score. I remember Phil Esposito. He got 76 goals 1 year. He got 65 the next. He said, "Phil, you're having a bad year. Put a lot of pressure on yourself with 50 goals now."
I don't really know if that's a lot of pressure. I'm not really worried about it. Last year, I didn't expect to score 50 goals, and I certainly wasn't. I was trying to, but I was surprised that I got there. And I took it a game at a time and tried to play well every night. And with the team I'm on, everyone is very young, and we're improving, and the talent level of our team has increased every year, and it makes it easier to play, and in turn, it makes you a better player. And as long as our team keeps improving, I think I'll keep improving, and statistically, we'll all benefit.
You know, let me ask you a question, and I think Scott over there will tell you. Do you think now that they have the magnets, that guys are taking an extra chance of going now? Did you take, would have you done that a couple of years ago without those magnets cutting in?
I'm not sure. Now I'm not worried about going into the net.
No.
And a lot of guys aren't. You know, you've seen that that same situation happen hundreds of times, yeah, where guys have slid into the net. And when I went in, I wasn't at all worried. Actually, I got my knees up trying to knock the net
off.
Yeah,
I saw that. Yeah. Wait a minute. We've Blue again. She didn't want to show this, but I said, describe what happened here. Go ahead, Blue. Run it again.
You know, I thought I could cut to the net and get in front. And there, I get my knees up in the air trying to, cushion the blow a little bit and knock the net off. And I guess I hit it on the outside coming across with its strongest, and it didn't give in at all.
It's an awful looking sight. I don't know. I think guys take an extra chance now, but I'll go along with you. Now, let's talk about one of my favorite guys in the league. Well, I don't even want to look at it anymore, to tell you the truth. Look at that. It's awful. Okay. Now, let's talk one of your favorite guys now. And, Stevie, let's be honest now. You get a lot of room out there on account of big Bob Probert, eh? Now, really.
Definitely. I played a couple years before Proby came along, and my first couple years in Detroit, we didn't have a big, strong physical team, and teams prey upon that and take advantage of it. And now we have Proby and Joey Kosher, and Proby's out on the ice. He gets that extra room himself, and guys sort of take a second look when he's out there.
He's the best fighter in the league right now, and you're not a bad fighter yourself. you know, he's a goal scorer and everything. Can I remember a time? We'll start with having Kevin McGuire ran at, who was it, Stefan, I think, Stefan, at the time.
Yeah.
Stefan at the time. Now, let's say, little Stevie, what he does against Kevin McGuire. Like, come on, Blue, like this one. Let's see this. Here it is again. There you go. You got McGuire. You're holding your own. It's all right. You got him up. There goes the helmet. You don't like that when the helmet goes off. You're doing all right. Not bad for a 50-goal scorer. Well, that's all right. He never got hurt. Here comes Probert in. You know that. Somebody's going to get killed. That's it. We never showed the rest of that. Goals, 300 minutes and penalties. Everybody would love him. Everybody love you. We're going to go to the bar. Put her there, Stevie boy. Good call. Good call. Good call. Good call. Question, you think it's going to be easier now that Gretzky's gone, Edmonton getting by them, but don't answer it. They watch this show. You don't need a, you know, no ammunition and everything. What do you think makes Gretzky and Lemieux so great?
I'm not real sure. I'd like to know because it might help me out a little. they both know the game a little better, or their anticipation is a little better than everyone else. Physically, you know, they're not they're equal to everyone else. They're not above anyone else, but just they know the game a little bit better, and they're one step ahead of everyone else.
Yeah, his dad. I had his dad on. And I asked him the same question. He said anticipation. He's about four ahead of everybody. He says, Lemieux, you're always against him. What's the story with him?
I'm always chasing him down the ice.
Yeah.
Well, Mario has a bit more of an advantage than Wayne because his size and his reach, and he's very strong also, and you just never know what he's going to do. Once I was cutting him off at the post, I was skating as hard as I could, and then he starts going around the net. The goalie's at the post with me, and he comes in and puts it in the open net.
And they always show it on the news, right?
Yeah, you see big number three there on the screen.
You should run from that there. Now, you were both drafted at 18. I hear a lot of stuff that's too young. What do you think? Do you think it's too young?
In my opinion, and obviously it was good for me and Scott as well, it worked out well for us, and it's worked out well for a great deal of other guys. But it's hurt a lot of kids too. So you know, it depends on, I guess, what side of the coin you're on.
Yeah.
It'll help you or hurt you.
What do you think?
It depends on the person. I think if they're ready and how far they've developed in junior, if they can make the step. And
yeah.
I think the individual knows himself. You know.
Yeah. I think it hurts a lot of kids though. Over the long, you two guys are all right. But I've seen. I remember in Colorado, we brought up some kids, and we had to send them back, and it broke their heart, eh? They were never the same. They went back to junior, and they felt like they were failures or something. Now, you guys are going to be in a tougher division. I know it's tough to say that your division's going to be tough, but with Keenan and Brophy's got better players. Now, the only weak link you've got there is Minnesota. They'll be scraggling along there at the end, but it's going to be tougher this year.
It sure is. I think you know, Chicago has a very talented team, and in every position they have a strong depth. With Keenan in there, I think they'll be a little bit more organized and have a little more direction, and that's all they need, I think.
I'll tell you one thing, they'd better be organized. He'll have them by the throat. The players call him Adolf. And it's not the seasoning, believe me. You know, your owner, I give it to your owner pretty good a couple of years ago when he brought on all those college guys and give them $9 million and everything. But I got to admit, he's a pretty good guy. After you guys get beat out 2 years ago, and then this year, he made up the difference for a Stanley Cup.
Well, he's a great owner to play for, and I've been there 5 years now, and he's done a lot of things that have never been done before by the owner of not just a hockey team, but any sports franchise. He runs his hockey team like he runs his pizza business, and he treats his people well, provided they give 100% effort and do the best they can for the organization. He'll treat you better than you could ask for.
Well, we never got into it, and I'm not going to talk about it, but the guys that got caught out in playoffs last year, I think cost him $16,000, so he can be pretty tough, too.
Yeah, you know, I knew it was expensive buying drinks in a bar, but that's a bit ridiculous.
Now, you both played junior hockey, and you both went to school. In fact, you were, what do you call it, scholastic or something like that? You did all right, too. You guys like junior hockey the way to go, right?
Definitely.
Yeah, there's no, for us it worked out great again, but I really enjoyed playing junior hockey, and it's more of a NHL style game, and as far as the amount of games you play and the travel, and it's much more like the NHL than any other route.
Well, Wendell Clark, I was talking to Wendell Clark, and I says, you know, the guys that play junior seem to have more character and inside. He says, yeah, he says, in college they don't drive for 10 hours on buses like they do out west. Teaches you a little character like that. Now, a career outside, have you got an, you're looking towards a career outside of hockey?
Actually, yeah, I've just, with a brokerage firm in Detroit, I've signed on with a firm in Detroit, and I'm in a, studying to become a broker, and hopefully in the future something will work out there.
What do you, Scott?
Well, I'd like to stay in the game as long as I can, playing, and then maybe get an assistant coach job or something like that for defense. I'd like to stay with the game as long as I can.
Well, go on television after, too, like
yeah,
me.
Don't want to steal your show.
Yeah. I got to say something. One guy on your team, yours was Gustafson. Yeah, I know the thing. One guy drives me nuts is Klima. And now it's not his earring. That doesn't drive me nuts. His earrings he has in his ear. His hair streak, that doesn't drive me nuts. But what drives me nuts is that garbage can helmet he wears.
Well, actually, we asked him to put that helmet on to hide up that ugly hairdo he wears.
I like it. I like it. Well, I'll tell you, Stevie, everybody here and Scott will go along with that. And you know, he's a very quiet guy, but you've seen this before. And, Gus, you've seen it before. Guys that are quiet, somehow, they get in the room and they lead by example. And I've talked to all Harold. Harold Snepp's a good buddy of mine. He says you're one of the best he ever saw. And I want to thank you for coming on, Stevie Ball. Thanks a lot.
Last week, our next guest, as captain of the Detroit Red Wings, led his team to a second consecutive Stanley Cup victory and was unanimously voted the playoff's most valuable player. Here now, the two-time NHL champion, Steve Yzerman. Now, is that the real cup, or is that like the courtesy trophy?
That's the original, actually.
That's the real one.
They have a copy of it, I believe, in the Hockey Hall of Fame in Toronto.
So they give you guys the original cup.
Absolutely.
Now, as the captain of the team, this is your responsibility?
It's all my responsibility.
No, but everybody on the team wants to spend time with the cup.
Yeah,
right?
We all and we managed to get it.
Yeah.
It works out over the summer, but it's had a busy week.
And it must be an overwhelming. At first, you think, wow, cool, but then it's got to be an incredible responsibility, doesn't it, to carry this thing around and be responsible for it?
Well, actually, we have the Hockey Hall of Fame sends a guy around, and he's kind of more in charge because we pass it on to our teammates. And
odd things happen, though, don't they?
Strange things can happen with it, yeah. That's why they're there to kind of chaperone.
It's been in the bottom of swimming pools. It's been in bars. It's been young women have shown their affection toward the cup.
In one way or another, yes. Yeah, it's been through it all. I don't know.
It's good looking. It's good looking. As trophies in the world of sports go, this may be the best looking trophy a person can be playing for. That's a nice job. Congratulations. Have a seat there, Steve.
Thank you.
You know, a few years ago, the Rangers won a Stanley Cup.
Back in 95. Wow. That was the year we were supposed to win it, actually.
And what's the deal on this Scotty Bowman? This guy like a genius or something? How many has he won?
He just, this was his eighth Stanley Cup.
Eight Stanley Cups. Has there been another coach who's won that many Stanley Cups?
He just tied Toe Blake, who was his idol. Yeah. I think Toe Blake was with the Montreal Canadiens.
So what is it that Scotty Bowman knows about hockey that the other guys in the league don't seem to know?
That's a good question.
Well, they don't give these shows to chimps.
Right, that's right. You know, he just, he's an older, older guy who's coached a long time. And he's really a fiery guy. Mm-hmm. He keeps
is it defense? Is it all about defense?
That's the strength of our team. Yeah, the majority is defense.
You swarm. You don't attack the puck. You attack the players. Is that how you this works?
Well, I don't do much attacking of the players myself. But we're a strong defensive team, and and actually we, up until '95, we were one of the better offensive teams. Mm-hmm. And Scotty finally came in and said we're going to be a good defensive team, and the transition has obviously worked for us.
Detroit is a great hockey town, isn't it?
Oh, it's unbelievable. You see the Stanley Cup go around town, yeah, and people just go wild.
It means something because there is that heritage. And when I was a kid, and obviously, I'm not telling you anything new, the NHL was six teams, right? That was
right,
just it.
Right, original six.
Yeah. You had Detroit, you had New York, you had Boston, you had...
Montreal,
Chicago.
Chicago.
And that was... Are we leaving one out, or did we get it? Was Toronto in the
six,
original six?
Yeah, Toronto, yes.
Yeah, and that was it. And it was a tough, tough game then. And the heritage goes way, way back, so the town must be beside
right,
themselves.
Right, well, just like the guys like Gordie Howe, the former Red Wings, Gordie Howe, Ted Lindsay, and these guys we still see around town, but they won the Stanley Cups. They won six of them up until 55, and then there was a 42-year drought until we finally won, last year. So the people were anxious to celebrate.
So you win the first one, and it must be a huge, okay, all right, we've been there, we succeeded. That must be a huge relief off the shoulders of the players. What's it like going into that second year? Do you think, if we win, great. If we don't win, who cares?
Well, no, actually, coming into the playoffs, we really didn't think that much about it. We got into the first round, and we played Phoenix, and the guys kind of really...
Phoenix, now there's a hockey capital.
It's a hotbed, yeah.
Hockey goes way back in Phoenix.
They're supported pretty well there.
Is that right?
Oh, yeah, it's a great atmosphere in the building there. Half the building is actually Red Wing fans anyway, so they follow us everywhere. It's just... around Detroit, it's just incredibly exciting for everyone.
What about that Eric Lindros guy? What's the deal on him? Is he going to be something or not? What's his story? What's the deal on
actually,
that guy? He's like 8 feet tall.
Yeah, he's a tremendous
hockey player. Don't they want a cup down there in Philadelphia?
They're
Aren't they going
one.
Crazy?
They'll get one.
Let's go, Eric. Pick it up
player.
A little bit.
He just needs a little bit of help.
It's raise like the game, Eric. I mean, he's seriously. He's like.
Hey, you know, he's a pretty good friend of mine. I got a deal with him this summer.
Fine,
so I gotta,
you know, good for you. It sounds to me like he maybe a head case or something. Paul, do you have any questions for the cup? All right.
No, Eric's a tremendous player.
What an athlete.
As his team gets a little stronger.
I saw you down in Washington with President Clinton. Was that fun?
It was. We had a great time.
You were like the spokesman. I thought you handled yourself very nicely. I saw the little press conference stuff. You did a nice job.
Thank you. It worked out great, and the team was thrilled to be there. And if you ever, the best part about it was the police escort from the airport to the. White House. It's like we all felt like James Bond, kind of racing around town. It was kind of the highlight of the trip, although meeting the president was good as well.
I'm a Canadian, so.
I understand.
So this goes a long way to helping erase the unpleasantness of the end of the season last year.
Yes.
And it must have been a great shot in the arm for you and the team and the community and everybody, huh?
Yeah, it was an incredible thrill, and winning it last year was tremendous. There was an unfortunate accident, a limousine accident at the end of the year, where one of our best players, one of the best players and toughest players in the league, Russian Vladdy Konstantinov, suffered severe head injuries. Yeah. And at the time, they told us that he may not live. So a year later, we were able to, without one of our best players, we were able to win another championship. And he was in the building, on the ice. Yeah. To celebrate with us. So it was very emotional, and it
good
was
for you.
Exciting. For
good
us.
For you, good for the Red Wings, good for Detroit. Nice meeting you, Steve. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Steve Yzerman, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be right back.
Well, obviously, you're going to have more of the quick changes on these lines here as we go into this second overtime. Gretzky had it, lost it. Yzerman picks it up. Yzerman moving. Blue line chance. Score! Steve Yzerman! Detroit wins! once again our final here in Detroit. It took a double overtime. The Detroit Red Wings have beaten the St. Louis Blues 1-0. For Bill Clement and all of our crew here at the Joe Louis Arena in Detroit, I'm Gary Thorne. Thanks for joining us. Red Wings win it 1-0. The length of the ice as he crossed center. The two teams changing. And in Fetisov dropped it back. Gretzky picked it up, couldn't find it. Yzerman is turning and coming in. Another shot, score! Yzerman scores! Detroit wins the game! Detroit wins the series! And they go on! This is over!
Seven games and an overtime period and a minute 15.